2005 Chrysler Sebring Coupe.
Aunt Metamucil is going to be watching you today. Now you remember, walk slowly and softly in her condominium, or all her porcelain knickknacks will fall out of her 8 armoires.
Chrysler Sebring. Now that's what I call luxury.
Teamwork. Okay, give me a layup. Just one layup. An easy car I can easily hate, so I can finally put one in my negative pile and not be that guy who likes everything. Oh, cool, a Chrysler Sebring. I should be able to drop trow and really take a dump all over this Wait, what? I liked it? Really? Alright, here's the deal. I could have said I hated this for internet points, and I don't think anyone would have blamed me. But in a general sense, you shouldn't try to force a certain mindset. Sure, you could, and just say you're being ironic. After all, if you're being ironic, there's no risk involved. But cynicism isn't the same thing as maturity. If you like a product, you should exercise your right to like it. And if you don't like it, then feel free to hate it and just ignore the backlash. If words can control you, so can everything else. Now, having said that, it's not like I love the Chrysler Sebring, but I also didn't hate it. The acceleration is basically nothing, and I had my foot on the floor while merging, and I kept waiting for something, anything, to kick in. But nope, it kicks down and it just gets louder.
Oh wow, I was foot to the floor. Come on.
This line was born in the 90s, but the Sebring feels very much of the 21st century. It's got that smooth-looking exterior concealing a bland interior and an engine from which you expect nothing, yet still receive disappointment in great big burly handfuls.
This Chrysler Sebring uses the Mitsubishi 4G64 2.4-liter single overhead cam engine, but it has 4 valves per cylinder, making 152 horsepower and 162 pound-feet of torque. Most Sebrings came with the 2.7-liter V6 because Chrysler sold this budget-built, softly-sprung Build-A-Bear ride as a luxury sports coupe. It's the same move Chrysler did with the LeBaron, and in multiple positions. They didn't even have to change the car. They just said it was luxury, or they just said it was sporty, and corn syrup breakfast cereal eating Weeble Wobbles financed it. And if that didn't work, they just made a convertible version.
But from its reputation, you would think the Sebring was undrivable, which really isn't the case. The acceleration isn't great, but I thought it was decently responsive, with fairly solid handling. The wheel didn't exactly fight me, even if I wasn't really taking racing corners in this either. In a sense, I was somewhat surprised by the build quality, if only because of the reputation. Then again, this is a car that's never really been tested before. It's a daily commuter for work and for short road trips, and in that sense, it performs capably. You want something that's going to last 14 years, even if it does end up needing repairs, because, well, it's still cheaper than buying something newer that probably doesn't have the same resilience. And it's kind of weird to think of this car as resilient, but I've driven cars newer than this that gave me or its owner more problems, whether it was poor response or worse handling or crappier build quality. I think with a stiffer chassis and a bit more power, this could have been more than it was. The problem is in trying to present this as a sporty vehicle, which, I mean, it's just not. It's a basic sedan, for the most part. In 2005, this was the car for the man who writes his will in Comic Sans. A man who wants to project an air of likability, at least until the summer cookout when he asks how you like your burger, but makes it his way no matter what you tell him. Because the quickest and easiest way to lose friends is to man a grill. Chrysler Sebring, for the kind of guy who leaves a $6 tip and makes sure the $5 is on top.
Chrysler Sebring, brought to you by Why Are My Front Wheels Always Dirty? Oh hey, I'm your friend Mike. I know why your front wheels are dirty, yeah. It's because your front wheels hit the air first, and then they get all the dirt. I'm smart. I always pay cash for gas. Let's go to Ruby Tuesdays and just eat appetizers. I just throw the floor mats out. All they do is get dirty.
Ugh, these headlights. Meguiar's Plasti X is $10. Just make your headlight clusters match. This is driving me nuts.
Don't you want to see at night? Don't you want to be bilaterally symmetric? How is it I figured this out, but everybody else found someone who loves them back?
Kimmy is dating a young man who drives his dad's Chrysler Sebring from 2005 to take her two towns over to see Three Doors Down. Whenever she comes to visit, the dad is blowing a lonely song on his saxophone, but she doesn't know enough about jazz to tell if it's good or not. All she knows is this is strange for a guy who's not even divorced yet. His jokes are cringier than an episode of SVU trying to tackle a modern topic, and Kimmy wonders if the son will grow to become his father. And she realizes she has a choice to make. If she really wants to put herself in a position to end up with kids who grew up to joke, "Hey, sorry I'm late, I didn't want to come," but actually mean it. If she really wants to hitch her wagon to a guy who doesn't know Hall & Oates aren't black. If she really wants to be with a guy with the hit-or-miss qualities of an avocado, because who knows when the damn thing is going to ripen? You're just rolling the dice and hoping that once you open it up, you can still make a decent guac with whatever's inside. So Kimmy saves the guy's phone number as maybe. Because committing to putting his name in there is too big of an ask right now. The Sebring was created in 1995 as a two-door version of the Chrysler Cirrus. The name comes from the racetrack in Florida, which is home to the 12 Hours of Sebring race. It's not exactly Le Mans, but then this isn't exactly a McLaren, so what do you expect? This is very much on brand with where Chrysler was headed during its late 90s decline through to the subsequent government bailout in 2009. It's uninspired, mostly because it didn't have to be anything more than the automotive equivalent of a good song that, simply through sheer exposure, you're completely okay with never hearing again.
Chrysler Sebring. The car for you if you buy Tylenol from the farmer's market. The bottles are already opened, the labels say Tylenol, and the seller only speaks in tongues. But hey, it's 81 cents. The Chrysler Sebring was discontinued after 2010, and it lived on, in some part, as the Chrysler 200 until 2017. Chrysler Sebring. Well, you've put your time in behind a point-of-sale machine for 40 years, through two kids, three dead parents, but, sorry, there's no SL500 reward for your retail Munchausen syndrome. There's no prize for self-flagellation. There's only a Chrysler Sebring. Enjoy this plastic interior that feels like a child's plastic slide that's been left outside all winter.
The Chrysler Sebring is a car that strains against its classification as luxury sport because it's neither luxurious nor sporty. When you're coasting at an uncomplicated speed over uncomplicated terrain, it has the capacity to be satisfying. But it's not a challenging car by any means. It's a perfectly okay car. Good enough to get by. And I feel like you'd be crazy to ask anything more of this car than that. It practically exists to be handed down. This is for Ben, who drives this car because it belonged to his dad. He wants a new car, but change is hard. You see, he's dating a girl named Kimmy, and he overlooks her little lies because he figures tiny fibs are just the hallmark of a growing relationship. I mean, it's understandable, Ben tells himself. After a while, you kind of get bored, so you inject little bits of narrative into your day to spice up the conversation. Kimmy might say, "Oh, the guy ahead of me in line paid for my coffee today." And it's plausible, right? Because there's no way for you to know if it's true or not, one way or the other. But then she'll say something that's a little harder to believe, like, "I was driving and got cut off by this madman on Route 61. He flipped me off and made me spill my coffee at the stoplight." And before long, Ben finds he's tuning her out altogether because he doesn't have the mental endurance to winnow the wheat from the chaff. So Ben comes to the realization that he has to decide whether this is a deal breaker or not, if having someone droning in your ear about things that may or may not have happened is okay, because at least the lies are little. Either way, the answer is the same. No, this is not a deal breaker for Ben. Ben wants change, but not so much of it that he'll actually have to. He wants change as long as he can carry it down the stairs. His phone rings. He checks the name. It's Kimmy. He's got to take this. Chrysler Sebring.
Teamwork. 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 Teamwork.
Well, wait.
Teamwork.
Chrysler.
Teamwork.
From 2005.
Teamwork.
We're just
Teamwork.
Two guys.
Teamwork.
And we're reviewing
Teamwork.
Cars.
Teamwork.
And I forgot
Teamwork.
My line
Teamwork.
In the next
Teamwork.
Part of
Teamwork.
This song.
Teamwork.
So I'm gonna
Teamwork.
End
Teamwork.
It now.
Teamwork. Beepus.
Oh.